a couple of Sangh Parivar representatives on one of the TV channels. They were two and I was one. Channel was a pro-right. So they obviously were two persons. The media also manages that, you know, two persons going on, you know, talking very aggressively. One thing that they were, first their objection was, why are you using a color like saffron, which is one of the colors? And what is the problem with the color? See, they make it so painful. That what you mean by why you are calling saffronisation? So obviously when you start debating on saffronisation and it's one of the colors and nature has so many colors and saffron is one of the colors. So why do you dislike the color, sir? That's how they start. And it's difficult to answer, you know, that why you like dislike a particular color. So the deeper content, the deeper processes cannot be captured by color. But I said that, look, you know, when you talk of the color, we are not concerned about the color. We are talking about something far more serious. So you may say communalization, and you know, I can say that, you know, see that what's happening in the destruction of the nature of social relations. But one of the arguments, I was narrating this to Vinayak this afternoon, that their argument is that, you know, how do you get your pride? How do you get your self-respect? They were continuously referring to me saying that I'm a Hindu, number one. They define, they call me Hindu. And then they started saying, where have you got this confidence? If your culture, your civilization, your long history, if that has not been glorious, how could you be such a confident man today? Secondly, they also said that you have accomplishment, you have self-respect. And where from you got this self-respect? So they locate the debate in a, such a manner that the way you have to define yourself, you have to define in your own context, historical, cultural, social. And what is the context that you people are talking about? And we are talking that India is very great, it has had a great tradition, and you know, and that's the reason why Indian culture, Indian civilization has been able to produce Haragopal. This is what they are arguing on the TV channel. Now, see how you have to confront. So I was continuously telling them, my confidence has not come from the past. My confidence is in future. I believe human beings are noble. I believe human beings are creative. Human agency is extremely creative. Therefore, human beings will be able to create a more humane, decent, equal, a fair and just world. That's what I believe. If not today, tomorrow. But humanity, mankind, will create a very humane society, and that is an offering. That's unfolding. I see those forces. Those human forces unfolding. And therefore, I see the whole confidence in the human being and in the future. And if you call me in terms of my self-respect and all that, I say that I have a self-respect, I'm a human being. I'm superior to the other species. I'm superior to an elephant, I'm superior to a tiger, I'm superior because I have language, I have communication, I have human reason. I have land, I can interfere, I can interfere with the nature, which other species can't do. The very fact that I'm born as a human being is enough for me to have a self-respect. What more reason do you want? Now, in other words, the debate today has become so difficult that for a common man, it appeals. What they say, it appeals. You know, yes, yes, no, where from we got, if you don't have a past, what is that past and you know, and what is that glorious past that we have had? And you know, they keep on arguing those. This is one thing. But another thing about maybe 4 or 5 years back, on history books and communalization, Ram Madhav, who is now the secretary of the BJP party, plays a very important role. He came all the way from Delhi to Urdu on communalization of history. And again, we were only two. But Ram Madhav, before we appeared, before the camera opened the studio, he said, "Sir, you are a professor and a very accomplished man. Now, when I argue with you, I am going to shout. And you should not misunderstand. I am telling you in the beginning itself. And since you are a professor, you are working in university, I am not a professor. Very difficult to argue with a professor to win. But I have a point. But it is very difficult to argue, therefore I will stop." And then he started, Romila Thapar is a Marxist, Mao is this, you know, went on saying, who is Panikkar, who is Anush Sharma, who is this fellow, who is that, what person we did, Omar Mishra, all Western methodologies, who is Karl Marx, Marxism is Western, Marxism is not Indian, and you use a Western methodology, foreign methodology to analyze Indian history, and all these fellows have used the Marxist method, therefore they are more loyal to the nation. Because your methodology is Western. Contribution, see, this knowledge is the collective heritage of the humanity. Whether the Karl Marx or whether whoever it is, even Indian culture, tradition, what Buddha is born in India. And all Chinese are Buddhists. If you go and tell Chinese that all of you are disloyal to our nation because you are calling Buddha to get up in India, what answer you can give? How can you go and argue like this? You are trying to argue that by how history is analyzed, how history is understood. And history has to be understood in the concepts of the present. And history is the dialogue between the present and the past. And history is the vision for the future. Then the type of history you are believing in, what type of future you can see, how, why India is in crisis, why there is so much of poverty, why there is so much of crime, why Indian people are more suffering, you have to explain. You have to explain, and therefore you have to go to the past to explain the present. And then, based on the collective experience of all of us in the past, what to be in the future? Now, what is the point? How to understand what is the function of history? Again he shouted. Then there was a break. Then he said, "Look for it, sir, don't misunderstand. I know." And then the end of that, he said, "Sir, I have come all the way from Delhi to argue with you. And our fellows will shout at me if I don't win the argument." My friends, they were telling, "What it is, sir? Why you are keeping quiet? Why you can't shout?" I said, "Look, number one, there was there the agreement. Number two, I can't shout. It's not in my nature. Okay? Then I shouted to everybody. It's not a part of our culture. Putting down, you know, silencing somebody. That's not a part. But why I am narrating these two anecdotes is that the argument is not very strong. Saffronisation is not a very strong argument. It doesn't have the depth. It doesn't have intellectual depth. They can't take on. This much I am sure. They can't take on. But what they do is that you must have seen from the Delhi 100 Ramayans to the recent Tamilian writer to Yuvanandamurthy that you must say whatever happened, one method that they use is silencing the opposition or going to physical threat. One of the problems of Saffronisation is the physical threat. And from my own experience, I realized that either the intellectuals or the academics or the democrats in India who stand for certain values, right, who stand for certain values, who are the world, who are morally, they have a standing in the society, but we lack physical courage. What do you do that? Nobody knows. If Anantamurthy is threatened, Anantamurthy is an individual, no? So there is a fear. If somebody attacks me physically, what will you do? That's actually several times. The entire methodology is either shout or physically threatened. This is posing a terrible, alarming situation to the universities. This is what they have done in Delhi. 100 Ramayana, they went and attacked. They said that they will be
instead of the academic council meeting. And Delhi University Vice Chancellor and Delhi University Academy, which were some of the disciplines. I myself was a part of Delhi University for a short period. But they are pretty outstanding scholars. Delhi University has great distribution of people. But the entire distribution community, they are sitting in the academic council with a group of hooligans come and disturb and say that nothing will you follow Santa Vitra, we'll see, you get out now, we'll see. I think it becomes a major problem and it's a challenge to our physical courage, not our moral, our understanding, our reason, our wisdom, no. It's a sheer physical courage which, for different reasons, I think academic community has not been. I can't place no, somebody comes and hits me, I don't know because I never slapped anyone. Unfortunately, democrats happen to be very humane. Very kind, very concentrated, understanding, let us see the other point of view. There may be some reason, this is our way. And they may tell us, shut up, what answers are there, tell us, Bahar Mitro. Bahar Mitro is in the country. Saffronisation in this country is being imposed more by the physical threat, by force and by hooliganism, not by reason, argument, dialogue, logic. This is one problem, but far more serious problem of Saffronisation as far as the curriculum is concerned, because most of the time when we talk of Saffronisation, we talk of the curriculum. One thing I can tell you, even as a child, when I studied in my high school in my own language, my education, if I recall, it was fairly Saffronized. But we didn't have this type of political, you know, force, it was not articulated. I was, you know, in my high school, there was a big lesson on Shivaji. Big lesson. Shivaji, you know, in the, we had a Marathi, this one, and, you know, we used to by heart what Shivaji has done, what Tanaji has done, what mother of Shivaji has done, all this was there. Patriarchal. My entire, I think, whatever I have learnt in the high school, no, it was very patriarchal, it was highly, but it was not politicized. Therefore, we have taken whatever syllabus was there in those days. But I think the roots are somewhere in the post-independent India when the curriculum was developed, only in the much later period when Romina and when they started writing history. But the language texts remained very, very, reactionary. Most of the language texts, in all languages remained very reactionary, but we did not reason out. We did not apply our mind very seriously whether this type of lesson should go into a textbook and all that. I think that tradition was there. But today, the danger of Saffronisation is not merely commonalizing the curriculum, because what they are doing is, everything they are tracing, all crisis of India is being traced to the Muslim group. You must have seen that one of the, Vijay, somebody who has written two volumes on Dalits, and he himself is a Dalit, Vijay Sharma, from UP, he's a member of BJP. And what is his interpretation of the origin of untouchability in India? His explanation is that when Indians, Hindus fought with the Muslims when they invaded the country, those who lost the battle, they were made untouchables by the Muslims. Now, more amusing is, who are the tribals? They said that when Muslims came and forcefully were converting Hindus, those Hindus who refused to be converted went into forest and settled down there with tribals. It's not that all of us were tribals once and we came to Bombay. No, we were all in Bombay. We ran away into Pakistan, virtually, or Bastar. This is a very strange thing. But our untouchability, even at Ambedkar, with all his struggle, was not able to trace the correct historical origin of untouchability. Even today we have a problem of tracing what is the origin of untouchability. And Ambedkar thought that maybe because of extra regulations between two castes, the children born perhaps have become untouchable. So he also was not having that historical, he struggled hard. He went to Upanishad, he studied Ramayana, Mahabharata, Rama, Krishna, he studied hard. But even today we have not been able to scientifically establish origin of untouchability. Here is somebody come and tell him, what is your problem? Why you are being so much of a result? Muslims came and they defeated Hindus, and some of the Hindus who are defeated have become untouchable. This is the, and this is what is going to be in the text now. And they are writing 30 volumes on 30 tribals in India. RSS now has a major history project of bringing 30 volumes on 30 tribals in India, how each tribal faced and confronted the Muslims, and how they have, and they therefore they are going and telling the tribal, you are a part of the Mahabharata battle, you fought on the behalf of Pandavas, and you also fought the Muslims. See, this is the historical, and the tribals, you know, they put a feel that you know, they are being co-opted. And they are giving them symbols, they are giving them a meaning, they are telling them history. Right? And the poor tribals who are living in that, you know, world of their own, so somebody is going and telling you fought in Mahabharata battle on behalf of Pandavas. So, then they say that we also have a great history. We have also history. We fought valiantly against the, you know, Muslims. They are not even talking the British. Again, it's whom the tribals in India fought, really. The greatest battles of tribals were fought in the British, not against the Muslims. But they are now not telling that we fought against the Muslims. And for everything, they want the entire curriculum and the children to believe that, you know, the whole, and now in the Gujarat, they have a textbook, they are saying that two independence days of India. Two independent days of India, 14th August and 15th August. 14th August, because Pakistan celebrates 14th August, but Pakistan is a part of India. Therefore, now they are saying, let us celebrate two independent days, and there is a text, you know, there is a lesson. Two independent days of India, 14th August and 15th August. See, this whole, you know, distortion of the history, now is going down and all that. But to my mind, even that, is all right, you know, whatever this disinformation or historical distortion. But more dangerous thing is dismantling of institutions. They are up to destroy entire higher education. Now, two things they have done. NDA government under Vajpayee, RSS always is very keen on education and particularly higher education. They are always keen. And first NDA, when it came to power, they put most powerful man of the, you know, Bharatiya Janata Party, whom RSS believed, Murali Manohar Joshi, as education minister. Most powerful man. And they wanted their mandate to be carried by Murali Manohar Joshi. And they found that he was not able to carry it. All of us resisted. University of Hyderabad, our vice chancellor came to the academic council. And he said, there is a letter from the MHRD that we have introduced a course in astrology. I said, astrology? What do you teach in astrology? In University of Hyderabad, all of us said. What are you going to teach in astrology? Then Vice Chancellor said, what should I write to MHRD? So I said, sir, you're right that you don't have necessary expertise in University of Hyderabad and nobody is interested, therefore we'll not introduce astrology. You think we had that much of space? We had that much of space in that point of time. Now what they have done is, they put a very weak person as MHRD minister. From a strong person, they changed the strategy. They changed the strategy. They brought a very weak person. And from the day when she is a terrible controversy, media also for some reason or the other, they go on. So, I mean, the media, you know, NDTV asked me in one of the debates on Kunti Rani. I said, look, I'm not going by qualifications and all that, she's intermediate and all that. I said, not that, you know, the fellows who are more qualified are better here in the MHR minister than Smriti Irani. Whatever Smriti Irani is a different thing. But we had a Kapil Sibal. One of the fellows who destroyed the education, he paved the way for Smriti Irani. He created a ground. You don't believe that what's the normal way, you know, I mean, this fellow has done to higher education. Now, Delhi University has been destroyed by Kapil Sibal. It has been destroyed. Today, RSS finds it very, you know, conducive that the whole climate created by Kapil Sibal, they pick it up and run it faster. Why he brought 483 course in Delhi University? And that was the time when Ramayana also came, the whole debate on Ramayana. That's a Congress government, it was not BJP government. When the Ramayana's Ramayana was written to all. Now, Kapil Sibal has introduced 483 course, and all of us are asking the question, why 483 course? There is no debate. No parent asked, no children asked, no student asked, no teacher asked. Nation never debated. He introduced 4-year degree course. And this 4-year degree course, when he introduced, It is just because foreign university bill was coming, and if the foreign university has come to India, America has a 4-year degree course, and our graduates will not be qualified to enter the American universities, and in America they will have a problem because they will ask that why 3-year graduates are admitted to American university when we are studying 4 years. To bring the Indian education on par with America, we need 4-year degree course under the pressure of the World Bank and under the global capital and American pressure. And he got 4-year degree course. Now, I was invited to All India Vice Chancellor Conference. I was heading a panel of 17 Vice Chancellors and Deputy and Justice. And these are who are these Vice Chancellors? Ambedkar University, Mother Teresa University, Tribal University. These are all Deputy and Justice. And other high-profile, profile Vice Chancellors are with other countries, globalization and all that. We were all Mahatma Gandhi, Mother Teresa, women Deputy and Justice. Now, Katal Sipal comes. I am addressing 400 vice chancellors of the country, and he says that two major problems of Indian higher education, one is the JNU, other is Delhi University. What is this? And then came Santapurta. Santapurta, why do you need universities? Why do you need faculty and all that? Connect your university to Harvard, connect your university to Stanford. 100% connectivity, your education will come international and you will have Harvard and Stanford standard. This is Sangh. Both these fellows left. And our panel was first. And panel chairman first were asked. I was very angry. And I said, what is this happening? 400 vice chancellors sitting here. Two fellows came and just taken us for a ride, just because they have power. Who is this Sangh? He left this country. The fellow doesn't understand Indian education. He talks about 100% connectivity. My village doesn't have 2 hours of power. Several universities don't have power connection. You go to Bihar. I went to Muzaffarpur University. Everybody asked for a generator because they said that there is no power. And here is 100% connectivity. Unless the whole nation is guaranteed of the power to start with. 24 hours of power. How can you connect your classroom to America? That's silly. And then, evening, when we had a dinner, our UGC chairman came and sat on my table. Haragopal ji, thoda direction bhi dekhiye na, thoda wind bhi dekhiye na, badal rahe na situation. I said, sir, what is this? Now, 400 vice chancellors sitting, right? And if we take this type of stuff, what will be the image of higher, what will happen to the future of higher education? But vice chancellors are those who are leaders of higher education. And they must get up and tell this nonsense will not take. What is this? See, next day vice chancellors are telling, bhai, achha English baat karega, to bhai, itna kaisa achha baat. I said, what is this? Then Kapil Sipal speaking good English, you are impressed, but not by what the fellow said. JNU and Delhi University are not India. JNU and Delhi University are not India. See, in other words, the entire education debate has become so trivial. So trivial. That is one thing. After him comes, the BJP government. Now he already created the crisis, enough of crisis in higher education. That's why I said, Smriti Irani, the editorial was pushing this argument. I said, no. I also want to talk something on, Kapil Sipal before I say something on Smriti Irani. What has Kapil Sipal done? He's a qualified advocate, very accomplished fellow. But what is the vision? He was responding to global capital. In other words, higher education became victim of the invasion of the global capital. Then comes communalization. Communalization and globalization, these are two assaults on education. Saffronisation comes in one way. And what does saffronisation do? What saffronisation is doing is, one, dismantling institution and completely unscientific, syllabus. Right? And the entire thing, the curriculum and the reason, human reason, assault on human reason. And this, on the one hand, they are weakening the institution, on the other hand, global capital is coming with a big design of having the entire, their institutions all over India. And this marriage between communalization and globalization is the greatest danger or greatest crisis that India is facing today. It's not only mere saffronization. Saffronization is not opposed. Saffronization is not opposed to globalization. In normal course, nationalism should oppose the type of invasion of the global capital in normal course. If I am a nationalist, I would have said 100 times before I invite global capital. If I am a nationalist, my indigenous technology, my indigenous knowledge, my indigenous history, whatever it is. But this nationalism is very strange. This nationalism of the Sangh Parivar, I am always asking them, Sangh Parivar, how do you define nationalism and what is your nationalism when the global capital is invading your market, your education, your culture? Why are you not resisting? They are very happy with this global capital. Now, I was telling Vinay that when I was arguing with these two fellows, I asked them, have I you said that our culture was very great, our tradition was very great, all that. Okay, now I agree that you say this nation was very great. Now foreign university bills in the parliament, why don't you oppose that and say you don't want foreign universities? India has enough of wisdom. We have a great history. We will have our own great universities. We will not allow foreign universities. Right? Now they are saying, no, no, sir, we need foreign universities. I said, why? And until now, Haragopal is not complete that, this, Hindu civilization, culture and all. If that is so, let us be happy with our own system. Let us build our own system. They said, no, no, we need. I said, why do you need foreign capital? They are saying, foreign capital come, we'll have a foreign capital. And why do you need foreign capital? They say, we have to buy weapons. Why do you want to buy weapons? We have to fight terrorism. To fight terrorism, you need weapons. For weapons, you need foreign capital. For foreign capital, you need foreign universities. But for the nationalists. This cultural nationalism devoid of economic nationalism and political nationalism, I think the shallowness of the politics. The bankruptcy of the Sangh Parivar politics is that it is not backed by political sovereignty of the nation. They hold on in political, at least political science. All concepts are changing. And I have been asking this question in Indian army because I have been, you know, interacting with the army. They were asking me to give some lectures on Maoism. I was always asking the Indian army, what are you doing on the borders? You are protecting the borders so that China does not enter, Pakistan does not enter, other countries don't enter. Why the East they should not enter? Why China should not enter? Because they will exploit our resources. They will exploit our culture. They will weaken our sovereign power. As a people, they need to live in their territory. This nation belongs to us. This is the concept of nationalism. Now, you are standing at the border, protecting the border. But the fellow is coming royally and taking what, you know, our Gautam was narrating what is happening in Buster. You are taking the minerals, you are taking the raw material, you are taking the bauxite. You are taking the raw material royally and you have a border. What is the sanctity of territory? In the whole notion of sovereignty, what is the sanctity of borders? Now, if you say that borders are not important, why do you spend so much money on the army? If the borders are important for culture, for history, for your economy, for your power, for politics, political people's power, and we decide our destiny. Now, in other words, see, what is happening is that the way that the global capital entered, and the communalization of the, you know, forces, I think they are weakening the institution. But today, now suddenly all of us started feeling that instead of working in a publicly funded institution, maybe there is greater academic freedom in a private university. And if you notice, in the national media, be it Hindustan Times or Times of India or Hindu, most of the professors who are writing the columns, right, they are all in the private universities. They are all in the private universities. Now that nexus between the private university and the media, because the image that is created by the private university and publicly funded institution, the scholars are not writing. Now see, in other words, the way they are building the image of the private universities and the foreign universities and public institutions are strangulated. Institutions are struggling. They have taken away 30,000 crores from the education budget. From 90,000 crores, it became 60,000 crores. Why? You don't need education. You have a right to education act. And you have, having said that this is a fundamental right, both don't provide the support, financial support. And if you don't provide enough of financial support, how are you going to enforce right to education? Now I have to withdraw the money from the education. Now University Grants Commission has completely dismantled. There are times when institutions in this country were very vibrant. When Upendra Bakshi, the Vice Chancellor, delivered the day he confronted the government with India, he told, the day he spoke to the Education Minister, Prime Minister, when the Mandal Commission, when the Education Minister, MHRD, said, please close down the Delhi, he said, it's not your business, it's for me to manage the budget. Who are you to tell me that you want to close up to run Delhi? But that was Upendra Bakshi. Today, the government Vice Chancellor is so vulnerable, so vulnerable, so weak. And all institutions. Now, in Udaipur, Sangha Parivar met, and Sangha Parivar has passed one of the resolutions that all appointments in the central universities will have to pass through Nagpur headquarters. That is one of the mandates. Now, every appointment has to go there. It's an extra constitutional force. It's something which has nothing to do with the constitution of India, legal system of India, which is a force, and that force today is exercising enormous influence on education. One of the major concerns is education. Now, friend, therefore, why we should be concerned with this whole question is, to put it slightly in a larger framework is, that there is an assault of human reason, rationality. Now, in other words, human society is unfolds itself as it has to move civilizationally forward, and we have seen the history that Christian orthodoxy played the role that today Sangha Parivar is playing in the 21st century. Christian orthodoxy also religio, Copernicus, Bruno, the world alike. But scientists fought. A Galileo fought. A Copernicus fought. They have not really found their ideas. A Bruno was willing to die. I think the science in the West has grown against the orthodox. An assertion of the academics against the orthodox. Now, today, suddenly you will find a situation after modern science came and we are teaching modern science, and the scientist is scientist, and he is supposed to be believing in causation, reasoning, right? And advancement of human reason, which has been accelerating the civilizational process, I think suddenly all of us face a situation in India where there is an assault on the very civilizational process. It's an assault on the advancement of the society. And that's the reason why we should be concerned. If the society has to advance, if the human society has to move forward, Indian society has to move forward, I think the assault that has come both from the global forces and the communal forces is something we should concern us. How do we build a pressure? How do we build a moral power? How do we build collective power? Right? How do we counter the situation that we have now suddenly, landed? I think is one of the great crises and also challenge. Acche Naira, yes. But bad, we are passing through bad days. What Narendra Modi said, you are in bad days and some good days will come. But bad days is true. We are living in bad days. We are really living through very bad times. In my own, I have been teaching for the last 4.5 decades, it's the worst period we are facing. Never in the university there was a crisis of the kind that we have now. No recruitment for the last 20 years. No recruitment. And I went to Rajasthan University, Udaipur University, very distinguished university, zero faculty in Rajasthan language. We have 2 members in the communication department. What is this you have done for the universities? Why have you destroyed these universities which have been built by a generation of scholars? Several universities, Bombay University, Madras University, Calcutta University, 150 years old. You say Harvard University is very great, Stanford University is very great, and you go on lamenting that your university does not find in the top 200 universities. How do you find a place? If this is what you do to universities, how will you find a place in the top 200 universities? I'm saying there is something wrong. Something wrong. I think people have to be concerned. And we have now an All India Forum for Right to Education. Anil Sargopal and all of us are fighting. And I am very happy to share it with you that in these 18 states, when we have gone to the larger sections of the people, in fact, from Kanyakumari to Kashmir, I went to Nagaland, the entire Karnataka, I have extensively traveled, but our group went all over India. People are worried about education. People are concerned about education. People are responding. And when you talk of saffronization, I'm yet to find, now wherever we have gone, yet to find from the hall, any, anger, saying that why you talk about the saff? No, people are saying yes, there's some big, there are some problems. People are saying yes, yes, quality of education is declining. People are worried. People are concerned. There's a widespread public opinion in India on education. But how do we organize? How do you create such a pressure in public opinion where Indian education is rescued and reason and rationality are brought back? And I think we have to confront. What are the methods of confrontation? One way is to build a struggle. A struggle all over India to protect, to promote a reasonable, scientific, rational education, social harmony, respect for diversity, right, and give confidence in the future. Saffronization, we are opposed because it is a negation of a civil educational process. We are opposed to it because basically it is anti-human, anti-progress. And unless we locate saffronization in this larger context of historical process, we will not be able to fight our country. So therefore we have to locate it in the larger historical context. And that's the reason I thought that once I come to Maharashtra and Bombay, you know that Bombay is a place where a lot of enlightenment. Bombay had such a long history. Today, for Maharashtra, whatever we read in the newspaper, that's not the Maharashtra we knew. This is the Haragopal, this is Maharashtra, CPDR, so many scholars are sitting here this late evening and trying to debate on issues. Everything is not lost. I am confident, but the battle has to be carried. And saffronization, I am opposed because it is anti-human. That's the reason why I feel that we should oppose. I thank the CPDR for giving this great opportunity.